Anybody blessed here today? Anybody blessed here today? Yes. Amen. I want to welcome those of you who are watching on video or online live stream this morning. Thank you for being a part of our worship service. If we're blessed, we have the joy of the Lord in us. Amen. I know whose I am. I know who paid the price to redeem me from the pit of hell. I know that it is the blood of Jesus that has cleansed me, bought me, changed my life, rearranged everything about me. I know that my heavenly home is secure. I know that when I take my last breath here, it'll be my first breath there. I walk in the presence of a living God every moment of my life. Amen? If you're here and you've experienced that today, you can say, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I know who my God is. So let me ask you this question as we ask, why do we do this? I mean, if you experience everything I just told you, which you do as a born-again believer, why come together and worship? Why take an hour out of your busy day and come into a location and sit in the presence of God and sing songs? Why do we do it? I'm going to just take one element out of this right here and give you a reason why we do it, what we receive when we do it, and how you get to do it. Go to Galatians chapter 5, verse 22. Why do we worship? Here's the fruits of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit. So if there's fruit, there's a soil where something can grow, right? Otherwise, there's no fruit. So out of the soil where it grows, and we're going to look at that too today, there's fruit. And here's some of the fruits. But the fruit of the Spirit is love. God is love, and in Him there is nothing else. The fruit of the Spirit is joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, and faithfulness. Gentleness, self-control, and against such things there is no law. All Christians model all of these all the time, right? Yeah, we wish. We try. But I'm going to hang out on peace today. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, and peace. Last night I asked the question, I said, how many of you here have the peace of God, like Paul says, that does surpass your understanding? You walk and you live with a peace like none other. Got one hand up. How many of you walk with that peace? That's what I'm going to look at today because this is absolutely critical to the believer's life. John 14, 27. Peace. Peace. It's the eirene. The God reigns in you that you get peace is literally what that word means. Peace I leave with you. Now who's he talking to? He's talking to the disciples. He says, listen guys, you've walked with me for 3.5 years. I'm going away. And when I go, I'm going to give you the Holy Spirit. And when you receive the Holy Spirit, I'm going to give you a peace. A peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Do you think they got to see Jesus model this peace? They walked with him? They did. They witnessed a peace in Jesus like none other. He says, this peace I'm going to give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Now, there's a condition on the peace. He says, the peace I'm going to give to you is yours to have, but it's your duty then to let not your heart be troubled. That's not coming from God. That's coming from you. I give you the peace, and it's your job to guard your heart. Not only do you guard your heart, don't ever let it be afraid. He gives the peace. He gives us everything we need. And as we live in the world, not the peace I give you according to the world, but the peace I give you spiritually, so you got to guard your heart and do not be afraid. Worship, then, to receive the peace, it's an attitude of the heart. Worship produces an attitude of the heart. We're here together, the heart is of the physical, of the fleshly nature is fallen. It produces an attitude of the heart, which produces an action of the lips, because what's in the heart comes out of the mouth, produces an action of the lips, which gives you peace in your spirit. Now, you can work this backwards. If you're a born-again believer, you have peace in your spirit, so your lips are right and your heart is right. But we're going to work at it from the other side, that if your heart is right, your lips should be right, and you have a peace of God. So worship is simply an act of obedience. You came here today, and to receive one of the fruits of the Spirit through worship, Wonderful song we just sang, here I am to worship God. Here I am, an open vessel to be used and to be filled with your presence, to get my heart right, to get my lips right, and for my spirit to receive that peace. You're going to leave here today because you were in an act of obedience to come, and you'll leave with the peace of God. That's what worship does. You ever think about that? I mean, a lot of times we come to church, well, I come to church to confess. Well, yeah, maybe you got sin in your life. You need to confess. Or we come to church to see the person I always sit next to. Can't wait to see him. Those are all cool things. That's the fellowship of the body of believers. And he says, don't forsake this fellowship. But you came to receive the peace. Let's go back to the question. How many of you walk with the peace of God? Don't raise your hand. I want you to think about this. The peace of God that does surpass your understanding. True worship goes beyond words, goes beyond the heart, and gets into the peace of the Spirit. Do you have the peace of the Spirit? Here's how you gauge it. What's coming out of your mouth? What's coming out of your mouth says what's in your heart, and if it's in your heart, it comes out of your mouth, and you have the peace. What were your words like last week? Did you ever get angry at somebody? Did you ever lose it on the kids? Did you model peace to the people that are around you? Here's the key. We got to learn to worship God in good times and bad times, because if we have the peace of God, it's always there. Right? Here's what Christians do. Christians come to church, and they're thinking they're doing something for God, which is wrong. God doesn't need your worship. God doesn't need your presence here. God wants you to come here to not forsake the body of the fellowship of believers so he can move in your life. So we come to church, and we receive these things, and then when we go out, you ever walk in a canyon and holler or say a phrase and it comes back to you? Anybody ever do that? It's one thing about living in the valley. Doesn't happen. There's nothing for it to bounce off of out here. The wind doesn't bounce off anything either. So when you're up against a wall and you holler at the wall and you say, peace be with you, peace be with you. You hear it back, right? So what Christians have a tendency to do is their echo chambers. All we do a lot of times as a Christian, and we say we're doing these things, all we're doing is proclaiming what we heard, but it's never been a change of attitude of the heart. So your lips are proclaiming what's not in the heart. And when we do that, you say, oh, I became really spiritual last Sunday. Man, we had an awesome worship, but all you're doing is echoing what you heard. Am I making sense? If you're only echoing what you heard, it never got to your heart. And you don't have peace. You're just an echo chamber. So the heart has to be in line with the lips. And if your action without the attitude of the heart and you become an echo chamber, your lips can write a check that your heart can't cash. Do I need to say that again?
Yes.
Your lips can speak a word that your heart can't cash. And I've experienced this many times in the ministry. They come in, they're all excited, oh, we're going to do this, we're going to do that, and it comes out of the lips, but the attitude of the heart isn't right, and they have no peace, and there's no action. Probably about 12 years ago, I had a lady come into my office, been worshiping with us for about 6 months, all excited about the Sunday school program, and we went through the material, and she's like, yeah, man, this is a good program. Man, I wish my kids would have had this when they were little, and they were from Minneapolis. And she's like, I want to head this up. I want to be a part of this, because she had little kids. I said, awesome, let's get you in the program. So we set it all up. They come church for a couple more Sundays, and then the Sunday that she's supposed to be over charge of the teachers and everything, she wasn't there. And I was like, well, where'd you go? So I called her. Oh, she says, I'm in Minneapolis. I said, what are you doing in Minneapolis? You're supposed to be at church today. You said you're going to be out of the Sunday school program. Yeah, we decided not to do it. We went back to our old church. I was like, really? The lips produced what the heart couldn't deliver. I've run into this many times. Not saying anybody's a bad person for doing these things, but if the heart isn't in line with what the lips say, you have an attitude that doesn't align. And it makes it very difficult for Christians because you became an echo chamber and other people in the community see you driving into this parking lot. Man, they're going to church. And then on Wednesday, they see you act completely different. That causes a problem. You don't wonder why Christians have such a bad rap, because that's what we do. The heart doesn't align with the lips. The fruit of the lips comes from the heart, and the lips should be speaking what the heart is leaking. There's a guy in the back of this room that can relate to that. He says, every time I sit in the presence of God, my eyes just water. I said, that's called crying. Yeah, well, that's not manly, you know. But when you're in the presence of God, like we are right now, and the attitude of the heart is right, the eyes will leak what's inside. That's a normal experience. Are you living with the peace of God? Is your heart in line with your lips? Let me give you an example. Two examples from the Old Testament. Daniel was called to bow down to a pagan king. How many of you sitting here today, mayor of Wahpeton, Breckenridge, say, there is no more worship unless you bow down to this God? How many of us would still come and would still worship no matter what they said? David said, there's nothing you can tell me that's going to cause me not to worship my God. Daniel, he goes to his apartment, he opens the shutter doors, and he looks towards Jerusalem, and he worships three times a day. What was in his heart came out of his lips, and he had a peace. The king hears about it. They send soldiers. They report back to the king. They said, this guy Daniel that you really like is still worshiping his God. And according to your decree, he has to be put to death. Daniel, is this true? Yes. Because what's in my heart is going to come out of my lips. And no matter what you say to me, I will still have peace. They take Daniel because according to the king's decree, the king liked Daniel. They threw him in the den of lions, and the king was torn up about this. He didn't want to do it. He liked him. They seal the door. The king doesn't sleep all night. He's anxious. He's worried. He's like, oh, but according to his decree, he had to do it. The next morning, he rushes down there, and he says, Daniel, are you okay? And when you read the story, Daniel says, yes. My God showed up last night. And he held the lions at bay, and I had a good night. The king was so excited. This is what he says in Daniel. He makes a decree, a pagan god, Daniel 6:25. King Darius wrote to all the peoples, nations, languages that dwell in all the earth. This is a pagan king. Because of Daniel's heart and lips and peace, he says, peace be multiplied to you. Isn't that crazy? Daniel's actions touched the world through the king. He says, peace be multiplied to you. I make a decree, king's decree, that in all my royal dominion, people are to tremble and fear before the Lord of Daniel, for the God of Daniel. Did that speak volumes? For he is the living God, enduring forever, and his kingdom shall never be destroyed, and his dominion shall be to the end. The action of a heart and lips that created a peace that touched a nation. So when you run into a situation, and if we might see that in our lifetime, can you stand firm and do that? Yes, you can. Look at the impact it had. He ended up changing the whole city. He ended up changing the king's heart. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, same story. You bow down to our king and everything's cool. No. We're not bowing down to your king. Well, then put him in the furnace. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego all go into the fiery furnace. And who shows up as the fourth person in the fiery furnace? God himself in an angel form. Showed up in the fiery furnace, totally makes the king irate. And he says, make the furnace hotter. And the guys who are pitching the straw or the wood, whatever, into the furnace died because it was so hot. Those four guys come out of that furnace, three guys and one angel, without the stench of smoke on them. Because the attitude of their heart aligned with what they said. And they went into a furnace with peace. Can you do it? Can you do it? There's a good possibility we could be presented with something like this yet in our lifetime. We don't know what's coming down the pipe with our governmental system. We don't know how many things we're going to lose as rights and privileges as a Christian. So, but when you have the attitude of the heart that produces an action of the lips, you're going to speak and say what the Spirit gives you, and you'll have peace. I think it's just an amazing thing that God gives. So I just honestly tell you this morning, if you don't have the peace of God and you can't stand in the presence of the enemy, you need to seek that today, because when he fills you with the Holy Spirit, you can stop taking your Maalox, your Prilosec, and whatever, everything else you're taking, and you can just bask in the presence of God because he has given you his peace. The Reini, not the peace that I give you, it's the peace from the spiritual supernatural. When I go to the nursing homes, I always tell them about Psalm 23. Everybody knows the psalm. Everybody can quote it. And most people light up when you start saying things that they can quote. Amazes me, and it'll amaze me, because I'll probably be there and I won't even remember it. They'll say the Lord's Prayer, the Apostles' Creed, Psalm 23, sing Amazing Grace, How Great Thou Art, the Old Rugged Cross, without ever using a book or a hymnal. And they don't remember my name by the time I leave. Isn't that cool? You know what that is? That's the peace of God that was planted in them. So every time I get to Psalm 23, I walk them through it, and they're like, oh, that's so good. You know, some of these people have been around me for 15 years, and I worry, you know, like, do you ever get tired of hearing my stories? Well, they don't even remember who I am. I mean, I had a guy tell me last night, he came into his business, and he talked to him for a while, and he says, I got to get going so I don't forget where I live. I mean, and he said he was serious. He had to go home. So he remembered how to get there. That happens. But you know, when you live with the peace of God that does surpass your understanding, I don't have to worry about that. God will take care of that. So I go through Psalm 23 with them, and when I hit, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. What it say in John 14, 27? Don't let your heart be troubled, and do not let it fear. They light up. They're like, oh, I can walk through the valley and I'll fear no evil. I said, no, you will fear no evil. You know why? Because a shadow can't hurt you. Oh, yeah, that makes sense. You know why? Because Jesus took the sting out of death. Jesus rose on the third day. Death has no power over you. So when you see a snake crawling on the floor and it leaves a shadow, do you have to fear it? Yeah, no, no fear. It's a shadow. When you see a shadow, it has no power. Death is but a shadow, and it has no power. Why? Because my Jesus rose from the dead. He conquered it. And I live with that peace. I live with that peace that he took care of it. So Matthew 10:34, Jesus said, I came not to bring peace. What's that about? He says, I came not to bring peace, but I came to bring a sword. Well, does the Bible contradict itself? No. What he's saying is the fact that I came to bring peace with the one who believes in me and Yahweh God. And it happens through the Son of Jesus, and you will have a peace. The sword brings division. It's going to bring division from those who don't believe and those who do believe. Here's our tension with the peace. We're trying to live in a world where we want peace with the devil and God. We're trying to live in a world where we say, I can have peace with the dark and I can be okay with God. We want the gift of God without the need of God. And if you're trying to have the gift of God without the need of God, you will not have peace. In fact, you'll be tormented more than anybody else. You got to be okay with standing firm in who you are. So, where does this come from? Where does this come from? The peace of God that surpasses your understanding. Where does it come from? I wish I could tell you that you go to the book of Talmud. Anybody here know what that is? At least one guy does. That's in the Catholic Bible. And I wish I could tell you that you could go to a book. Oh, here it is. Do this and you'll have peace. That's not the case. Peace is the consequences of your actions. Peace is the consequences of your actions. It's only produced by what you do. Let me give you an example. If there's no forgiveness in your heart, do you have peace? If you're carrying guilt around today, do you have peace? If you're carrying shame, do you have peace? So it's the consequences of your actions. If you're carrying unforgiveness, harboring anger towards your neighbor, there's no peace. If you're harboring anger towards your spouse today, How many of you fought on the way coming here? Don't raise your hand. One started to go up. There's no peace. If you're harboring any of these things, Jesus says, listen, I give you peace, not of this world. So stop trying to bring the world and the peace of God together. It's the consequences of your actions. David got this figured out. David understood that he could worship and praise and be in the presence and the peace of God at a time when nobody else had it. Read Psalm 51. Psalm 51 really doesn't apply to us because Jesus rose and we have the Holy Spirit. In the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit would come and settle and then he would leave. David says in Psalm 51, he says, take not your Holy Spirit from me, but restore to me the joy of my salvation. So he knew what the presence of the Holy Spirit was like. David figured out how to be at peace of God, in the presence of God, and praise God at a time when the only people that got to do that were the ones who went into the Holy of Holies. Let me explain to you just how critical that is. They had to light their incense burner from the incense altar with the same fire. They had to have the blood of the animal that God specified to take in. And only then did they go in into the Holy of Holies with the same fire and the blood. They sprinkled it on once a year. They put bells on their ankles so they knew that they were still walking around and they're alive. And they came back out. David writes in the Psalms that he was in the presence of God at a time when nobody else was. How'd he do it? How did David figure out to be in the presence of God? The Bible says that it's the key of David, and if it's the key of David, there was something to unlock, right? You don't give somebody a key if there's nothing to unlock. It's the key of David. David figured it out. And look at Ephesians 5, 15 through 22. Paul's into it years later, and he gives us another key. Don't get drunk with wine, for that's debauchery, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. God does the filling of the Holy Spirit. As you sit here today in his presence, he's filling you. It isn't something you can conjure up and do. God does it. So when we sit in the presence of God and we come together in worship and we have a praise band leading us in songs and hymns, addressing one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, singing, and making melody to the Lord with your what? Heart. There's the attitude of your heart. So when the attitude of the heart is right, out of your mouth comes psalms, hymns, and singing, which we make melody to the Lord. Did you just get that connection? When the attitude of the heart is right, no grievances against anybody, hence why a lot of churches start out a worship service as a time of confession. It's like your prayer time. So the slate is clean, the heart is right, the attitude of the heart is right, and they lead you into music. And now we can sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, singing, making melody to the Lord out of your heart. It's the consequences of your actions. The consequences of your actions. David got it figured out. He knew what it was like to be filled with the Holy Spirit. When your intention, what's the number one thing you do? Praise God. When you're ready to twist your hired man's head off because he just tore out 40 acres of corn that you just planted, praise God. When you're ready to rip into your boss because he just fired you, praise God. It makes no difference when the checking account's fat, the car's new with new tires, no bills, praise God. 3 years later, the car's shot, totaled it out, checking account's zero. Where's God at when I need him? Praise God. David figured this out. The key to the presence of God to have the peace was when his heart was right, his lips were praising God in good times and bad times. Hence, David can say, I praise God all the time. Some of you look like you just got hit by a Mack truck. Praise God in the hard times. That's the learning here. Instead of going to God, social media is awesome. I think it's a great way to communicate. I think all the forms of communication we have right now are amazing. At the same time, they can be horrible. How many times do you see on Facebook somebody gets angry at God because of what's happening? Okay, that can happen. But at the same time, praise him. Praise him when the garden doesn't grow. Praise him when the house needs a new roof. Praise God. That was the key that David figured out that Paul writes. He says, make melody to the Lord with your heart. I grew up in a very traditional church. Very traditional. Stood up, sat down. Stood up, sat down. Say this, say this, say this, say this, say this. Preacher preaches 12 minutes, sit down. Stand up, sit down, go home. That was what we did. Yeah, it was an aerobic exercise. But the little country church that I went to was filled with the Holy Spirit. There's good people there. But the thing that when you study this, psalms and hymns, all of the hymns that I grew up singing are still in here. It's just like going to the nursing home reciting the Lord's Prayer in Psalm 23 when they don't even know their name. Those hymns and those psalms are still in here. And I'm going through this. I started to make a list of the hymns that I knew. I know all those hymns because I sang them. Because it was an attitude of the heart that I was being taught, and it was an action of my lips that created a peace within me. Praise God. How many of you go through your day singing praise songs? I'm not talking ZZ Top, Bachman Turner Overdrive. I know I'm dating myself. That's after Danny Kaye and all those guys. I'm not talking those. I'm talking praise songs. So what if it's a hymn? Amazing Grace will come out of my head at the most craziest time. I'm singing Amazing Grace. Praise is what brought David into the presence of God. I just read an autobiography about a pastor that had served for 50 years, and he was 6 months into the pastorate. And this woman in the congregation was bound and determined to destroy him. She was making accusations against him that he should have never been ordained, he should have never been a pastor, he didn't know how to preach, he didn't know how to do visitation. It was just, list was going on, and she was just relentless. She would even go over to his house and knock on the door and get in his face, say, hey, you need to quit. And he's like, oh, man. One night at 2 o'clock in the morning, she's in the backyard. And he hollers out the window. He says, what are you doing? And she says, I'm planting a bomb out here, so when you dig in your garden, you're going to blow up. And he's just getting angrier and angrier. He's in his car leaving one day, and she's in the driveway coming into the house. And he says, I was going to run her over. And he said, I got right up to her skirt. And he had it all figured out. He says, I'm just going to tell the cops. She's saved. She needs to go home and see Jesus before I do. He said, I was furious. Went into the house, and he told his wife, he said, I can't deal with this anymore. The next time she comes, I'm going to hurt her. She has to be taught a lesson. And an old seasoned pastor in town heard the story. He goes over to the guy's house, and he says, listen, what do you think's going on here? Crazy woman's trying to take me out and tell me I can't preach the gospel. No, no, no. He says, that's not the case here. He says, do you think this is a tool from the enemy that he wants you to fall in adultery? No, he says, I'm not attracted to her at all. So he said, what is it? He said, it's a very fact. The enemy knows you have a temper. And the enemy can get you to step down and fall out if your temper acts out to the point you're going to hurt her. He said, all you have to do is the next time she comes, the next time she calls, is praise God. That can't be all I have to do. He says, all you have to do is praise God. 2:30 that morning, the phone rang, and she's laying into him, telling him he's got to quit. The church is going to fall apart. He's got to step down. He's not a man of God. And he said, the sweat started to come out of my head. My stomach was turning. My hand was shaking. And he wanted to let her have it one more time. And he goes, praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. Oh, my God, my God. And he just went into this, and he said she just became furious. She started ripping into him. You can't do this. You can't say these things. Shut up. And he said, I just started praising God. And all through the rest of the phone time they had, he's praising God. This God of mine saved me. He redeemed me. I sing praises to his name. I praise my Savior. And she's hollering at him, and he's praising God. She hung up, and he never heard from her again. Yeah. Praise God in the hard times, in the bad times. What John 14:27 say? Do not let your heart be troubled. And do not let it fear. Those are the only two prerequisites we have to receive the peace of God. Do you think this pastor had peace? He had a successful 40-year career. because he understood that in the hard times he had to praise God. David, this is what he did, Psalm 34. I'll bless the Lord at all times. David figured it out. Put this psalm into context. He's in a cave with 600 men of valor. Saul's hunting him down to kill him. David had two opportunities to kill Saul, and he didn't do it either time. He's still on the hunt. He's still being sought after. He's hiding out in a cave, and he says, I'll bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. How many of you, after being on the run, you got 600 men that don't have any food that are following you? You're being sought after to be killed, and these guys are standing with you? And you're in a dark, dingy cave, and you say, you know what we're going to do? Praise God. You run the risk of those men killing you. Literally. So he says, here's what we're going to do. He's going to model it to the guys. We'll bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. What does Paul say in the New Testament? I boast in who? Jesus, my God. Paul knew that already. David knew that already. Let the humble hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. Put this in the context. 600 men are listening to him. Next verse. I sought the Lord. What's the New Testament say? Seek God. And he answered me. Imagine that. And he delivered me from all my what? Fear. What's the prerequisite? No fear. David mastered it. Those who look to him are radiant, and their faces shall never be ashamed. Many scholars believe that when David was worshiping and doing this psalm, his face became radiant, and the men watched because they were so moved. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him, and he saved him out of all of his troubles. And the angel of the Lord encamps those who fear him and delivers them. Any of you want an angel of the Lord encamping around your house? Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Fear the Lord, you his saints, for those who fear him have no lack. Checking accounts empty? No lack. No fear. The young lions suffer want and hunger. Why could David say that? What did he do with his father's sheep when he was a young man? Lions and tigers and bears? Oh, no. He watched it. He said, the young lions suffer want and hunger, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. Come, children, listen to me. I'll teach you the fear of the Lord. What man is there who desires life and loves many days that he may see good? Keep your tongue from what? Evil, attitude of the heart is an action of the lips. Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking deceit. Turn away from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. Verse number 12. Go back there. Verse number 12. Forward one more. What man is there who desires life and loves many days? Who here wants to love many days? How many of you want to live many days bad? Right? What's the purpose? What's the purpose of harboring anger, fear, and resentment and let your heart be troubled and live many days bad? David says, listen, you praise God and you stand in the presence of God. You have the peace of God and you live many good days. Ephesians 6, when you hit that, he says, in the day of evil is singular. Here David says, when you're praising God coming off your lips, you have many good days. I don't know about you, but that's where I want to live, that I may see good. Many good days. When the heart isn't troubled and there's no fear and I live in the presence of God. Peter and Silas are chained in the center of a prison, just been beaten half to death, and they start singing praises to God in the middle of the night, and what happens? Prison doors are open, everybody's set free, guard gets so scared he says, run me through because I'm going to die in the morning anyway. No! They had an opportunity to minister to him, and his whole family saved and baptized because they were praising God. Without fear and without trouble. The relief is in the praise. Anybody get this by now? The relief is in the praise. You go to the doctor, he sits you down and he gets in your face and he says, you got cancer. Some of you have witnessed that doctor's visit. And you can sit there and say, praise God. How do you do that? You just got news that the baby in the womb has died. Praise God. You just got news that something tragically happened in your family. Praise God. You see, when you praise God, it takes your focus off the tragedy and focus on Him, and He can deal with the tragedy. Praise God. The relief is in the praise. If you don't feel like it, do it. If you don't feel like doing it this morning, do it. You didn't feel like coming to church today? You did. That's where the attitude of the heart has to override the action of the lips, because that will produce the peace. How many times have you felt like, yeah, I ain't doing that today? Martin Luther went as far as saying this in his diary. He said, the busier I am, the more time I have to pray. Luther spent 2 hours in prayer in the morning, and he said, if my day is stacked full, I'll push that to 3. And when I do that, I'll still get my job done. Praise God. He had it figured out. We can certainly figure it out. If you praise Him, He will let you all the way into His presence, which produces a peace. Anybody ever sit in the presence of God? Anybody ever talk in tongues in the presence of God? Anybody be immobilized in the presence of God? Anybody tip off your chair in the presence of God? I think when we die and when our first breath is there, it's a moment of silence, which may be for an eternity. To be in the presence of God, He asks us to be there today. He asks us to live there. He asks us to have the correct attitude of our heart, so the action that comes out of our mouth and our lips is correct. And when that happens, there's a peace that does surpass our understanding.